Wednesday and July all month at 6 o'clock. Talks are conducted on interesting topics delivered by various eminent scholars. Today, 2714th talk on translational effort in health research is going to be delivered by Dr. G. Padmanabhan, former director, Indian Institute of Science. On behalf of Bangalore Science Forum and all of us here, I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Professor Govindarajan Padmanabhan received his BSc Chemistry from the Presidency College, Chennai, MSc Soil Science and Agriculture Chemistry from Indian Agriculture Research Institute, New Delhi, and DSc from BHU. After obtaining PhD Biochemistry in 1966 from the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, he became Assistant Professor 1969, Deputy Director 1993, and also Director 1994 to 1998 IAC. He was a UGC British Council Exchange Scientist at the St. Mary Hospital Medical School, London, and a visiting scientist, University of Chicago, 1973 to 86. After his retirement from IAC, he worked there as an emeritus scientist, honorary professor, distinguished biotechnologist, and old NASI Platinum Jubilee Chair. Professor Padmanabhan was instrumental in ushering in recombinant DNA technology in the country. He showed that curcumin from turmeric has anti-malarial activity. He worked closely with several government agencies to further the cause of biotechnology in the country. He helped and promoted vaccine industry in the country and supported his colleagues in the development of recombinant hepatitis B vaccine and DNA rabies vaccine. He chaired several committees of the Department of Biotechnology and was part of several initiatives to promote life science research. He was a member of the WHO group on malaria for 3 years and served on the INSA Council 1991-92. Professor Padmanabhan was recipient of Padma Shri 1991, Padma Bhushan 2004 from the Government of India. He got S.S. Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology 1983 and Jawaharlal Nehru British Centenary Fellowship of INSA. He was C.V. Raman Research Professor of INSA 1991-96. He was an elected fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, National Academy of Sciences India, Allahabad, and Academy of Sciences for Developing World. With this brief introduction, once again, I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Padmanabhan.
Thank you for the introduction. I've been a regular customer for this lecture series. The entire series, probably I might have missed three or four, other than that I have been around and very great pleasure for me to be here every year and talk on some topics which are probably general interest. I have chosen this topic of translation efforts in biomedical research. I just want to tell you what is the scope of this topic. Biomedical research involves, as you can clearly visualize, research on a variety of diseases, both lifestyle diseases, infectious diseases, and so on. All this research that has gone on, has it been translated into some products? Or therapy, or prevention, or diagnosis? Where are we in India? That would be the emphasis of my talk, basically. It will cover things like vaccines, biogenetics, I will tell what biogenetics means, diagnostic tools, medical instrumentation, and where are we and what is the future? What is the science that is now exploding that has to be harnessed if we have to compete in the global arena, not only competition, if it can be used for improving the health of our people? That would be the coverage which I will be planning. Now, in this sector, I will be talking about biogenetics. What do I mean by biogenetics? Some of you may know what a generics means. Normally in drug industry, these are all small molecule drugs, paracetamol, aspirin, like that there are so many molecules. India has specialized in generics, which means they have been able to make these molecules out of patent at a much cheaper cost. Very complicated drug molecules in the international arena, they will be just waiting for patent to expire. They have started research some 2, 3, or 4 years ago. We have very good brand of chemists, organic chemists in this country. And although it was a problem in the beginning, now India has become a global leader in genetics. We are supplying initially in a European doctor, Cipla, made HIV drugs for 1/10 the cost. Initially in the developed world, and WHO even said, how can you make this if it is all spurious? Eventually they resorted to Cipla. You are the one who has to supply drugs to the Africa. That is how it came. So India is a leader in genetics. The same thing is happening in biological molecules. What do I mean by biological molecules? Today, discovery of drug, new drug has become extraordinarily expensive. It is estimated that to bring one drug to the market from research, it costs in excess of $1 billion. $1 billion. And if you see in the last decade or so, you won't have a new drug molecule at all. No drug molecule. So all the drugs that are now in the market are biological molecules. I will give you, as I go, I will give you an example, then those who are not familiar, they will understand. For example, these biological molecules, up to 1988, FDA, US Food Drug Administration, had approved only 5 biological molecules. Insulin, growth hormone, hepatitis B vaccine, alpha interferon to be used in cancer therapy, and tissue pathogen activator for the same. You will see these are all proteins. You also have examples of nucleic acids. That means they are all very high molecular weight molecules compared to the classical drugs which are all small organic molecules. That is the difference. And many of these proteins will exist in the body itself. Insulin, our body produces insulin. But all along it was insulin insufficiency, depending on whether it is type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes. The only source for you make insulin from pig porcine. Pig was the essential source of insulin all along, till recombinant DNA technology came. where you can take human insulin DNA and put it in yeast, and the yeast will now make human insulin. So today what you have is recombinant, you are treated with human insulin, not with animal insulin. Treating with animal insulin has its own problems. But that was all that was available. But now, with the recombinant DNA technology, you start making all these growth hormone, hepatitis B vaccine, you were also involved, we made one. Alpha interferon, as I told you. Just five products were approved as of 1988. This became 125 products in 1990. FDA approvals have been around 30 products on an average in the last 10 years. And in the last 2 years, 40 products per year. Therefore, you will see big drug companies are now moving into this area. Their products are all biological molecules, antibodies, monoclonal antibodies, especially for cancer. Now I want to, my talk is going to be confined to the Indian scenario. Now we can talk, this is happening, that is happening elsewhere, what is happening in India. That is what my focus would be. But before that, I want to give you the history of biotech industry. I am conveying biotech is a very broad subject. It deals with the health and disease, food and agriculture, environment, industry, and so on. I am only confining to health sector. Now these are all classically known institutions, Pasteur Institute in Pune, King Institute, or King Institute for Preventive Medicine, name changed again to Madras or Chennai, then CRI in Kasauli, Afghan Institute in Mumbai. These are all established late 1980s, 1980s, before the start of 1900, late 1890, 1899, and so on. Or early 1900s, and they did make smallpox vaccine, polio vaccine, cholera vaccine, rabies vaccine. Classical vaccines, not the modern vaccines. But you remember, my generation, we were all, you know, that sacrification, the sanitary will come and then give the smallpox vaccine, and smallpox was eliminated in this country. These are classical vaccines. Then came Bluestone antibiotics in 1954. They made penicillin, streptomycin, gentamicin. These are all small molecule antibiotics, but they are all produced by living organisms. They are not synthetic molecules. Serum Institute in Pune started in 1966. Today, Serum Institute is a global leader in vaccine technology or vaccine manufacturing. Biocom, right in Bangalore, 1978, Kiran Mizra Shah started. It's actually a sada that she started in the shed making enzymes for brewing. She had a degree in brewing. From that onwards to do what today, her company is making insulin, monoclonal antibodies, and all statins, and all the molecules. And it's a big journey, difficult journey. As a lady, as a woman, she faced a lot of problems of discrimination and so on. But she said, first biotech company in India which announced IPO. Aster is a center, in fact, it was established in 1986. It's a Swedish company, as you know, Aster Zeneca. For some reason, they came to me in 1982. It helped them set up the center, and they functioned in my laboratory for 2 years at the Indian Society. Before they moved to their own premises, and of course, further they went to they are fantastic premises, excellent facilities. But 2 years ago, AstraZeneca decided to close down all their operations in India. Unfortunately. They say corporate reasons, whatever. Shanta Biotechnics in Hyderabad, established in 1993, was the first company to have made hepatitis B vaccine, recombinant hepatitis B vaccine. You know, this virus has a protein which can be used as a vaccine. But even they made this protein using recombinant. As I said in the beginning, like insulin, they used the DNA and put it in a yeast called Pichia pastoris, and the yeast was making the hepatitis B antigen, which becomes the vaccine. We also made it at the same time, 1 year later. But Shasta really put India into the global map that we have a recombinant DNA protein. Then came Bharat Biotech, there also vaccine companies. So this all happened, public sector, private sector. Now you see, government, what did it do? The Department of Biotechnology was started in 1982 as a National Biotechnology Board, which became a Department of Biotechnology in 1986. And it promoted life science research all over the country, established so many institutions, National Institute of Immunology in Delhi, National Center for Cell Science in Pune, DNA fingerprinting in Hyderabad. They have some 8 or 9 institutions spread all over the country. And they supported research in many institutions, like IIT. They have all been great beneficiaries of the government support. IITs, IISCs, universities have all been supported. Centers are established, but translation is my important. Our quality of basic science research has considerably improved in the country. Today, India can compete with best science elsewhere in life science. But if you ask this question, how much of it got translated? What is the product we made out of this great research? We all ended up publishing papers. And, of course, the example I gave you, we made hepatitis B vaccine, cholera vaccine, modern cholera vaccine, streptokinase. These two were made at IMTEC, Institute of Microbial Technology in Chandigarh. They made these products. But hardly 3 products. And we all used to claim we will make this diagnostic to detect malaria. I work on malaria diagnostics for this, diagnostics for that. We all made them, but they didn't work in the field. When it went to the internet, scientists did not realize what it takes for a product to go from a laboratory to the field. They are very different ballgame. You know, their requirements are different. Stability, for example, stability of a protein. In the laboratory, you keep it at -20 degrees. In the field, it has to work at 40 degrees in atmosphere temperature, whatever. So it does not work. Now we have learned the hard way, really. That came real game changer for translation. This happened about 10 years ago. I have been chairing these technical committees right from the beginning, so I can tell you the entire history. The then secretary of the Department of Biotechnology, Dr. M.K. Barth, had this great way. They have been supporting academia in a big way. And quality of science has improved considerably. But still they are not translating. They are still not finding products. Then why not support industry directly? Will that work? You know, youngsters, especially with PhD, now feel that industry is different. It's not the father, son, that kind of industry anymore. These are all young PhDs who have been abroad like us, everything, but they decided to start a company. That is the environment today is happening in India, I should tell you. And then, last 10 years, it has been a game changer. SBIRA is actually present, not in the United States for industry support. We borrowed that idea but modified it to suit Indian conditions. Small Business Innovative Research Initiative, SBIRA stands for that. Now, the deal is the government will give 50%, the industry has to contribute 50%. That is how this scheme has been working for the last 10 years. And you would be surprised, I'll read statistics a little later, there were a lot of takers for this. Initially, the funding was of the order of about 2 crores, that order. But then soon one found, people have crossed that limit, they have achieved something. Now then what? They have established a proof of principle. Maybe it's a new vaccine they were trying to make, or a new diagnostic they are trying to make, or a new medical instrumentation they are trying to make. And you are not going to get a product out in 2 crores, then we have to start another entity called BIPP, Biotechnology Industry Partnership Program. That means those who have successfully completed this degree, they go to this BIPP. Because somebody has demonstrated the proof of principle, now he wants to do a clinical trial. Now clinical trial is very expensive. So these budgets go up to 10 crores and 20 crores. Again, the industry has to contribute to it. This is what is happening. So initially, this is what was happening. Industry used to, all these CRM institutes I'm talking about, global leader, this is all body shop. The entire technology is obtained from elsewhere, outside the country, not from India. But they all have innovation in downstream processing. Downstream processing means manufacturing. They had a lot of innovation. They know how to cut costs, how to at the same time make a good product. They are very good at downstream processing. Of course, as I said, academia was only publishing papers. But this has changed. This is what I am trying to convey. What happened was, 4 years ago, we had SIBRI, we had BAPP, then IEA came. If you really want youngsters to get into it, they are all people who have started industries, they are coming first of all. But we want catchment area. Young people, maybe PhDs, who have gone abroad or have not gone abroad, but they have an entrepreneurial bent of mind. They want to start a small industry. Many of the people came to us once they had experience in CPR and BNPP. Sir, we have ideas. But we have no money. We are all young people. And we have support family already. So, we came up with this idea called BIG. Biotechnology Ignition Grant. Biotechnology Ignition Grant gives up to 50 lakhs to a young entrepreneur. A PhD or an MSc who wants to work in industry environment, he can get up to 50 lakhs grant for testing his idea in 18 months. If within 18 months he is able to establish the proof of principle, then he can go to SIBRI, he can go to BIPP, then he can go to contract research and then try to get funding. So the whole pathway is now built. BIRAC is only 4 years old. But BIRAC is only consolidation of all these activities which was already going on. And BIRAC is a Section 8 company. Earlier it used to be called a Section 23 company, now it's called a Section 8 company. This is the first of its kind in a government system, a department, government department starting a company for research, for supporting research. So this is something very unique. And the government is extremely satisfied, very happy. They now want to expand BIRAC. I will come to you. Now, BIRAC already in the last 4 years, there is an established linkage with the USAID, the Wellcome Trust, the Melinda Gates Foundation, the French, French company, a French research establishment. In addition, of course, all the Indian institutions, so FICCI, CII, now BIRAC is established in all this, is expanding, is exploding it. Now I quickly in a way come to what are all the products. I will not get into this, read this, but I will just give you examples of what is being done or what is being achieved. Look at vaccines and biogenetics, I gave you a little bit in the beginning. Now you see India is now making bacterial vaccines, viral vaccines, polysaccharide vaccines, recombinant vaccines, only one. Diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, BCG, cholera, these are all examples of bacterial vaccines. Viral vaccines, measles, polio, rubella, like that. There are some of them, most of them are classical vaccines being made by companies like Shatha Biotech has been taken over by French companies. Now I think Sanofi has taken it over now. This is the other problem which our Indian companies face. Somebody is doing well and they can compete, the MNCs will take them over, buy them out. This is a standard thing which I don't know how to handle it. And combination vaccine has become very important. What do you mean by combination vaccine? It is estimated there are 12 kind of diseases for which the child has to be protected, for the child is adult. Diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, TB, like that now, the inflammatory, the respiratory diseases, for 12 vaccines. Now 12 vaccines, each one we have to give a booster, 2 boosters, 12 to 3, 36 times somebody has to be poked with an injury. So there is a big problem there. I will come to it in a minute, delivery system. And the other thing is, can you combine these vaccines? Instead of giving one by one, can you make 5 vaccines together? A lot of research is needed. because these are those protein molecules, many of them you can't combine arbitrarily, they are precipitative. So you have to do research. No, we have pentavalent vaccine, we have hexavalent vaccine. Pentavalent means four, five vaccines have been combined. And then this is what you will see in the market, pentavalent vaccine, hexavalent vaccines and so on. But we still have a challenge how to make up more combination vaccines. Cold chain is a big challenge for us. Vaccines have been stored in the refrigerator to be functional. Many times you find vaccine, because vaccine mediated death. This is unfortunate in the country. Media doesn't understand. Maybe the vaccine was not stored properly. Many times these vaccines have undergone extraordinarily trials for safety. Suddenly they will say three children died out of polio. Then you will say there are religious sentiments against some of these vaccines, especially polio. It will affect women's fertility. It's totally baseless. And that is why you are not able to eliminate polio in some countries actually. So these are all education problems, you know, programs are also active today, scientists said. But vaccine has saved millions and millions of people right through the history from smallpox to everything. But cold chain is a problem. Can you have a vaccine that can work at room temperature? Can you have a vaccine that can be stable at 40 degrees? So this research is still going on. These are all some of the challenges. Pneumococcal vaccines, the respiratory vaccine, we need, there are what we call serotypes. It's not only one type, it's all pneumococcal vaccine, all right. But there is 15 different types of pneumococcal which can cause a disease. It's like dengue. You know, dengue 1, 2, 3, 4. Your vaccine has to protect against all these four. I have the same problem in malaria. It's not enough. Plasmodium falciparum causes malaria, but there are different states of Plasmodium falciparum. And it is like, there's a story, mythology story. One of the asuras used to come back. You kill them with one head, he will come with another head. You know, repeatedly. Like that, this parasite, for example, you make a vaccine for one antigen, but these antigens are 50 genes. That means there are 50 of these type are there. You make a vaccine for one, next season that antigen is not there, the other one has come up, for which the vaccine will not work. So these are some of the biggest challenges in developing vaccine against many of these what we call serotypes. It's not one type, there are many types of the same organism. That is the challenge actually. And as I told you, another biggest challenge is delivery. How do you deliver without injection? Needleless delivery is the biggest challenge. So we have virus-free particles, oral, nasal. Can you just get the vaccine through the nasal route? Thermal patch, can you put it on the skin? Some of these are working actually. You know, still, I don't know, still it is not a clinical practice. So these are all some of the challenges, and India is really doing some of these things at this point of time in many labs in the country. Now, from vaccine, I go to biopharmaceuticals. Again, I want to tell you, a biopharmaceutical is a big molecule. It is not a small organic molecule which goes to the definition of a drug. These are all proteins. These are all nucleic acids. So like, India is now making insulin, erythropoietin, growth factors for cancer, serum albumin, streptokinase, interferon, many monoclonal antibodies. I don't have time to go into great detail what a monoclonal antibody is. Just tell you, streptokinase is the one that is given the first injection if somebody has a myocardial infarction. The clot has to be dissolved. And that is where you give streptokinase. The earliest you give the injection, better it is. Now, we have made recombinant streptokinase has been made in this country, but this is a big challenge still today. It's selling at 40,000 rupees. The other version will say it's 10,000 rupees in the market. Still, it is not affordable. That is our biggest challenge. Many of these products, it's not enough if you make a modern product, you have to make it affordable. Now, my complaint with the industry has been these are all, I told you, biogenic molecules, insulin, growth hormone. That means they are already known, they are out of patent, therefore we can make. We are not infringing the patent of anybody. so companies can. The prescriptions are even more that can be made. India has made up to 20 products. But already our business sense takes over. Everybody is branding them. You know, you will have 250 brands, 40 brands of insulin. You know, you go to the market, how many brands of paracetamol you buy? Each one has some different name. You know? Brand, 55 brands of erythropoietin. This is okay for a business. We have to do all that repackaging, but we need to make new products. We have to make at least 50 generic products. Now, new drug discovery. I told you the small molecule, I said not a single molecule has come, even internationally speaking, and India doesn't have much chance in my assessment. They're extraordinarily expensive. Expensive because not only the research point, you make it, but then you have to go through what is called as preclinical toxicity in animal models. You have to do phase one trial, normal human volunteers, you have to show it is not toxic. Then phase two trial, efficacy trial. Phase three trial is large number of patients. Then phase 4 trial is after the release of the product in the market, you follow it up and that is called, that data is known as phase 4. Extraordinarily expensive. So I don't think India has a chance, but what India is trying to do, repositioning of known or failed drugs. There are thousands of molecules which are there in the libraries, as we call them, which have worked well but have been dropped for some reason or the other. They have all gone through the trials, but dropped maybe for economic reasons, dropped maybe for patent reasons, dropped maybe it didn't give the type of expectation which they look for in the Western world. Huge number of molecules, you can try them for some other application. This is known as failed drug or repurposing known molecules. One example, we are looking at the project Galmabax. Galvax is something you use for blood pressure. It's a failed drug, but they are now using it to treat diabetic foot ulcer. It's working. So this is an example of that kind of thing. So another important thing which we can do is go for herbals and natural products. We have a great tradition of Ayurvedic therapies, but they have not been scientifically validated. They have not been validated using modern science. And this has been a big debate, argument. The Ayurvedic physicians will say, why do you need, we are treating the human. I've been treating for so many years. But there is no authenticated proof, as we call it, you know, scientifically proven, that this has worked. That's why you feel all our products are sold as food supplements or drugs. They are not sold as drugs. Chinese drugs are not sold as drugs in the US market. That is because they have done the scientific validation. We have to use modern science. We have to do clinical trial. Parameters are there. Biochemical parameters are there. Physiological parameters are there. Toxicity parameters are there. Can we get them done? That is very important. Otherwise, of course, it's still available. People are treated. Some people have strong belief in this, what we call as alternate systems of medicine. They have their own strengths. But I don't think you can read. I have given examples of some of these preparations that are available, and we know the active principles that are working in these. But in spite of that, they are not becoming allopathic equivalent to allopathic. Well, there are also natural molecules. These are all preparations. Already preparations have complex mixtures. That is one area. The other one is active natural molecules. Instead of synthesizing them, you isolate them. Some of you may know, last year Nobel Prize was given to artemisinin. The only anti-malarial drug that works effectively today. And that is isolated from this plant called Artemisia annua, China. Chinese drug. But if that lady got Nobel Prize last year, after so many years. Like that, there are, I have been working with curcumin. It is a tremendous possibility. It is from turmeric actually. It can cure a lot of things, but there is no scientific validation in that sense of acceptability. It's not an approved drug. It's not an approved allopathic drug. Despite all, there are so many trials, there are so many patents, so many publications, but still it is not an approved drug. This is what we are trying to do something there. Like that, there are many guardian types of glycosides in polyphenolics. They have anti-obesity, they have high activity in polyphenolics. Green tea will come. I'm not talking about extract, I'm talking about pure molecules that have been obtained and known properly. Can we take them all the way to make the drugs? Now I come to devices. You know, innovation in diagnostic device, medical instrumentation, mobile health and telemedicine, wearable technologies, quickly go on to all these are projects which are being done in India. I tell you, Bio-Rad is supporting these projects. It's not theoretical anymore. Lateral flow ELISA, these are all diagnostics to detect infection disease, cancer detection. These are all being made, HIV, HPV. These are various types of hepatitis, viruses actually. Then people have developed what we call a skimmer chip, eye chip, sepsis chip, cancer chip. Just give one example of it, because of time. Fever chip means you can get fever due to so many infections. Cholera will give fever, malaria will give fever, some other virus also will give fever. How do you identify which fever is due to what? Therefore, there are now people are right in Bangalore, a company Exciton has built a DNA chip because each organism has a DNA which is different. Can we identify that? The chip contains, say, 15 such fragments of DNA which can do what we call a PCR reaction and then identify. This bug is responsible for this. Like that, you can have eye chip, you can have cancer chip. Some of the examples of the things that have been made in India, I'll come back to it again, I think. And diagnostics have been further improved. You know, we have, this is basically, there are two principles in diagnosis in modern science. Either you identify the DNA, which is unique to that organism. Malaria, parasite as a DNA, which is very different from the human DNA. Therefore, you can identify. Or, malaria is a protein, which is very different from the human. So, if you have an antibody, we call it as antigen-antibody reaction. On that basis, you identify. Those are the two principles. All these equipment are all made on that, but you need to further improve the sensitivity of this. That is where the nanoscience coming in a big way, nanoparticle-based, fluorescence-based, thermium, europium. These are all being added. The antigen that is coated now will contain europium. So the detection becomes, because of fluorescence, highly sensitive. And one such example I want to have given is the Indo-Finnish collaboration. India is giving the antibodies and so on. Finland is giving the nanoparticles. Now, the next few slides will give you the type of medical instrumentation which the industry is trying to do. In the Bio-Rad system actually. Photodynamic laser therapy system. I'll just read some of these. Self-expanding percutaneous IoT bar technology, novel microfluidics based flow analyzer, affordable fluorescence reader for point of care diagnostics, high fidelity affordable vanaquine for effective cardiopulmonary restriction. This is, vanaquine is just a, you know, prototype of the human where the nurses can be trained, you know, to identify the disease, treat them and so on. Digital oncopathology slide scanner, cardiac markers using micro cantilever technology. You know, IIT Mumbai boys are coming to study the same DNA, antigen-antibody interaction using micro cantilever. Retinal imaging device for retinopathy of premature bleeding. You know, the retinal imaging of babies is such a big problem. So there is, somebody is trying to measure automated portable epilepsy, EEG system, flat panel computer tomography, imaging device for monitoring breast tissue changes. You know, based on thermography, people are trying to early stage detection of breast cancer. Wearable transducer, I'll come to it in a minute. Mobile continuous, I can go on reading one, just give you this example. Mobile continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. You know, people who undergo dialysis know that being twice a week, thrice a week, they have to go and get the dialysis done. Now this guy is trying to develop a machine which is like a backpack. You can carry your dialysis within you. He said you can go to the work, you can do your work And in between you take half an hour gap and get your dialysis done. So this is extraordinary. You know, they are very nice progress has been made. There are many other devices like our device for screening, newborns for hearing loss in resource poor setting. So I have given you just a number of examples of some of the devices that our industry, young people are trying to make. So many people say nothing is happening in this country, a lot of things are happening in this country. This is what the message I want to give you. Then mobile health is very important. What is mobile health? You know, you very village setting, the unorganized sector, they can't go to the doctor. Many times I have seen reshufflers will buy a packet for 5 rupees from somebody there who is a local doctor. And he has 4 pills, I have seen. There is one for EJs for headache, one for stomachache, one for diarrhea. They will buy it for 5 rupees. It doesn't matter what ailment they have, they will just swallow that pill. That is the stage we are in this country still. So, if they cannot go to the doctor, can doctor go to the, you know, can a device system is available? That is where the mobile health. Of course, it has other implications in the abroad and all that. But in India, it becomes a great boon to take care of people who cannot go to the doctor. And that will institute. You can do the analysis, is it possible? And transmit the information to the doctor who is elsewhere somewhere. Television. Combine it with television. This is what is happening. Television market is valued very highly and so on. This is what the company is. I'll just give you an example. Two examples of this project. One is a mobile phone platform for blood glucose analysis. Software platform turns mobile phone into a diabetes monitoring platform, enabling lay users like health workers, patients to analyze blood glucose test strips using phone's camera, track symptoms and lifestyle data, and transmit data to a physician for follow-up. Glucose is measured in a strip. You know that principle, I will not get you to reuse glucose oxidase and it will develop some color. And you can do large number of people and then through your phone camera and the mobile phone, they are transmitting this information. Not only that, other data as is given, they are being tracked. Another example is rural primary care diagnostic device. This is a project that is just having Dabha, that's it. He says inside the Dabha, he has got everything. He has got a microscope, he has got a multi-ray calorimetry and centrifuge, there's image processing, dry chemistry, to suit the solution to the limited rural skill set. With the help of the device, the range of core tests will be addressed: glucose, hemoglobin, blood counts, urinary tract infection, malaria, TB. They can detect, you know, we have funded this project looking at how is it simple. He says, I will carry it in my bike. And I can go to the village and do this test, and they will use their cell phone, transmit the message. I don't know, the cell phone is really something phenomenally is being made use of. Then what we call as wearable technology. He says, come, you know, some kind of wearable belt, these are all sensors through a belt mechanism, which will give you a lot of information. And of course, it has. Because it can even remind the person apparently in the Western context when you should take the drug. That, you know, message will go, you have to take the drug next 5 minutes or something like that, I don't know. But in India, you know, it's basically a sensor that gives the message to your smartphone. I just give you an example. Wearable health for pregnant women to monitor fetal health, that is, heartbeat. If pressure, blood pressure, and so on, it can be. Continuous monitoring of ECG doesn't become a lot of advancement sensors or aspects. In fact, this company, I forget the name of the company, they came to me and then demonstrated. It's some kind of a bell linked to their cell phone. And he says, as I am driving, it will measure CO2 carbon dioxide in the environment. I am an asthmatic. And if the level is more, I will get a message saying, don't go to the area. You know, this is very, you know, people are very innovative thinking. You know, this is something phenomenal. I hope they succeed. Additive manufacturing, 3D printing, you know, this is like basically it means, I'm not an expert in any of these areas, I have just picked up reading these projects which come for evaluation and so on, I'm not an expert. 3D printing is simply making a three-dimensional molecule in the computer. Any three-dimensional molecule you make in the computer, and it has to be added layer by layer, layer by layer, layer by layer, you build it. And then to translate that, it will be a real product. And there's a lot of technology, a lot of mathematics, a lot of physics that is involved. So I just want to give you one example. In the institute, there are a couple of students with aerospace, and the thing that is happening is the kind of people who are collaborating is very, very different. A biologist is collaborating with the aerospace engineer, and they are looking at somebody outside the system and a company, and they have made a liver chip. They have actually made liver cells using 3D printing, and it is a 90 well plate. Each plate will contain a liver piece or a liver hepatocyte. Of course, media will exaggerate to say they will make organ, full organ, you can have your own liver, all that. Long way off. But at this stage, it is very useful for drug screening. See, one of the requirements in drug is toxicity. When they develop a drug, they will go through animal toxicity testing to say, because the drugs are metabolized essentially by the liver. Liver plays a very important role in drug control. Whether the drug works, doesn't work, is it metabolized, not metabolized. And there is a huge problem with animal disease coming, you cannot kill animals, you cannot use animals and so on. Now this is human liver cells are put there in the chip. So you can screen the drugs again directly against human liver. Is it toxic? Does it work? Then you know this is something which is, I hope, they succeed. Artificial intelligence, you know, this is something smart, medtech devices, I don't know how much is happening in this country. This is another big data analytics. No, because of our ability, computer science is so well developed in this country. Big data analytics has come in a big way. There's been huge amount of data. Of course, in the human genome, we have been looking at it. Like, you know, the DNA has 3 billion base pairs. How do you, not only sequence, how do you interpret the data? How do you analyze big, big data? 24,000 microorganisms have been sequenced. Each microorganism contains a DNA. All the DNAs are being sequenced. How do you analyze this data? How do you handle this data? You really need computer intervention. IT people are now getting into it. It is more application rather than just DNA analysis. It is application in public health. Because in public health you have yes. See, we are doing it in R&D sector, but you know it's a big thing in terms of diagnostic tool. Can you get, like, you know, we don't have statistics. How many people are diabetic in this country? How many people are taking insulin? How many people are responding? What is the progress of the disease for the whole country? Is it possible to get that information? That is where big data analytics will be very useful in public. I'm just giving you one example. Like that for any disease, and many times our statistics are very poor in this country. Disease statistics are very, very poor. So big data, there are companies right in Bangalore, I visited a couple of them, who are into this area. They will take many diseases and then see whether big data analysis of public health. And they say, we will give this information to the government for surveillance, for what kind of steps you should take gradually. Phenomenal possibilities are existing and India is into it. These are some of the things which have been developed. You know, this is readers, fluorescent readers, fibro, is there a cosmetic application? This is a handheld PCR, polymerase chain thing. To detect the DNA, you need what is called as a polymerase chain reaction, which will amplify the DNA billion fold in 2 hours in the test tube. It used to be big equipment. How do you do it for malaria? One parasite, yeah, I want to detect the DNA, I have to do a polymerase chain reaction to amplify the DNA so that I can identify it. Today we have a handheld PCR machine, right in Bangalore, big tech company has made it. Government abroad also. Government we are just copying. Like that, two vaccines have been made. Rotavirus vaccine has been made. H1N1 vaccine has been made. This is that one I told you. This is for different application in shrimp. Shrimp industry suffers. It's not really in health area, but still, it's a major industry. Shrimp export are killed by viruses. And there are PCR, I've told in Andhra Pradesh coastal line, all the farmers have PCR machines to make sure their shrimp is not contaminated with the virus before they export. That means if you make it available, accessible, train them, you don't need a big degree. They are all able to understand this, or they will hire a MSc or something like that to do these reactions. So it is possible to translate. Well, this is the statistics in the last 4 years. The VIRAC has supported 509 projects, 110 with academia collaboration. I told you that one of the problems have been that academic research is not collaborating with industry. Now, this is changing. At least to start with, you see 110 projects are with academia collaboration. This is because industry is now coming to the academic partner. Academia was not going to industry because they were publishing papers. Now, industry recognizes that if you have to be innovative, new ideas, new thoughts, you have to go to the academic community. Slowly, we'll find more and more, and the VIRAC is supporting both the partners. It will support industry, it will also support the academic partner. So, some more statistics. Companies 350, entrepreneurs are 170, new startups have come in 104, small and medium industries 129 products have been developed. I gave you some examples, a few of them. Intellectual property generated is 100, early stage technology is 25. And one issue is, having done all this, how did they go? How did they manufacture? And you need funding for that kind of, this is where the problem, angel funding, investor funding, this comes at some point of time. Industries go up to a point, their product is ready, but still they need money. Somebody has to invest. You know, there may be some impulses, there may be some charges, very little. Most industries feel like going to Tirupati and putting money in the Hindi rather than support these. You know, but that, I hope, you know, people realize all these small companies require a lot of investment. And that is where you find about 20% of these projects in the last 4 years have been able to get follow-up money. Investors have come forward to take their companies invest. Now, quickly, I want to take some time and tell you, this is where we have. And biotech industry is growing at 20%. The turnover is about $6 to $7 billion. So the government is very excited. They think it's a great model, things are working. So they have put a target of $100 billion by 2025. $100 billion by 2000. How do you achieve it? Now this import, all the biogenetics means import substitution. We really need to innovate. That is where the new science that is happening, we need to understand where we are. That is where I think synthetic biology has come. Now I will not get into each one is, you can give few lectures on each topic. Principally, the synthetic biology was developed by engineers, not by biologists. A few biology engineers got together in Boston, MIT, and then decided, can I make a cell to be a machine? We are making machines. Machines consist of wire, transistor, valve, diode. A cell will have genes, RNA, protein, and the protein expression will be there. Can you make a cell as a machine? That is their concept. And that is where, which means you can put all these things and try to make totally unknown new molecules. Is it possible? I hope, I don't know. This is a circuit diagram, just like in electronics. You also have a circuit diagram in the cell. You can make circuits, promoter, activator, there's a feedback loop, and you can measure the output. And I must tell you, this is an area which attracts a lot of attention. Every major company is into synthetic biology. And these are various areas, whether it is perfume, or whether it is paint, or whether it is cosmetic, or whether it is agrochemical, there are companies catered to environment to synthetic products. Just tell you what the US is trying to do, just to see where their future is going to be. They are tackling impossible today industrial projects that will become possible if we enable scale and rapidly prototype genetic designs and operating systems. And they have called what is called as a 1,000-molecule project. They want to make 1,000 molecules, innovative new molecules which are not known even earlier. This is where the field is. And that is where we are just at the beginning, at the base level, so far as synthetic biology is concerned. And we will need it if you have to get your $100 billion thing. This is where, you know, our youngsters are all, you know, very, very eager to get into some of these areas. Similarly, you have systems biology. You know, this is another new area, not really new, because I'll tell you the examples by giving it become easier to understand. Now, systems biology is something, it's not linear reactions anymore. We all used to teach biochemistry. Glucose is broken down to this pathway and then gives carbon dioxide, energy, as a linear reaction. It's no more linear. Each step is interacting with 100 other molecules. It's like a cycle, web and a spoke, and you know, it becomes extraordinarily complex. And mathematically, it is very complex. And that subject is known as systems biology. To understand every system in the cell, for example, you see cancer network. We all work somewhere here. And then say, I'm working on cancer, I'm finding a cure for cancer. But you see, the complexity of the interactions between pathways, between molecules, is extraordinarily complex. And this is not a complete cancer cell network, I can tell you that. Again, many of you may or may not know, we all harbor trillions of microorganisms in our body. This was not recognized till some years, a few years ago actually. They influence somebody's susceptibility to a disease, somebody's susceptibility to be cured. Trillions of microorganisms are there in our body. Now, how do you understand? Many of them cannot be cultured. When you say microorganism, you put it in a medium and it will grow. Like that, it can grow only 1% of the known organisms. Unknown organisms, you don't know how to grow them. But that is where the DNA technology is very important. You don't need to know the organism. Simply isolate the DNA from blood, isolate the DNA from the gut, and identify all the DNAs and then characterize these organisms. If they are not known organisms, give them a new name. That is where data analytics becomes. Big data analytics, trillions of organisms, DNAs, how are you going to analyze them without big data analytics? This is where exciting things are happening. Gene therapy. I'll take 5 minutes and finish. Now, gene therapy is by definition a defective gene is replaced by a normal gene. Somebody is suffering from thalassemia. That is because their hemoglobin is defective. Can you replace that hemoglobin gene, defective hemoglobin gene, with a normal gene? This is a simple approach. This has been going on for the last 30 years. One step forward and two step backwards. That is because we know the principle, we don't know how to deliver the DNA. How this DNA will replace the defective DNA? How does it do? So you need a carrier for that. For example, they used adenovirus as a carrier to put the DNA. And the patient died of the other trial study, the person died of adenovirus toxicity. Not by this DNA, but the carrier killed the individual. So immediately there was a trap. They said you have to go back to the drawing board or something like that. For 1 year, nothing could happen. Like that, there are so many examples that can give one step forward, two step back. But recently, a lot of exciting therapies are possible for hemophilia, factor 9, thalassemia, globin, fat metabolism, cancer, Parkinson's disease, even dementia. They are all most promising, still not a clinical practice, but there's a lot of hope that this will be real. India has to get into it in a way we have been doing. The last example is stem cell therapy. Stem cell is something, you know, it's a primordial cell in the body which can give rise to any other cell in the body. It can be obtained from the embryo, it can also be obtained from the adult. can you replace degrading cells, neuronal cells? As we age, neuronal cells are depleted. Can you regenerate those cells? Can you regenerate cardiomyocytes? Can you regenerate muscle cells? That is the scope of stem cell. But still, it's not a clinical, ready for clinical practice. It's a research. Although in India, there are advertisements, what they call the autologous stem cell therapy. You take stem cell from the patient and put it back to the patient. That's not correct to do that. Ethically, it's very wrong to do. Because stem cells also harbor cancer stem cells. So, you know, instead of curing the person, you may be creating cancer in the A lot of research is needed, but especially in North India, these big advertisements are there for stem cell therapy. People go to Korea, people go to China for stem cell therapy. But internationally, it is proven, it is approved for only one application, for eye application, apparently, in Europe. A new stem cell-based treatment repairs damage to the cornea after injury, like a chemical burn called holoclaat, has recently received conditional approval in Europe. Other than that, everything else, of course, the classical bone marrow transplantation that Dr. Bellon will do, Christian Medical College, for leukemia. There are no, everything is under trial, everything is under research, we are not ready yet. I told you about the linkages which they have, but at the same time, if you think, all I saw you need synthetic biology, you need systems biology, you need data analytics, no. Innovation, yeah, I don't see many people here, but innovation doesn't need any of these actually. There's one example is how do you handle the thyroid challenge? People, this is something, a big problem in this country. How do you deal with it? There were Gates Foundation came to Biolac and they said, can you handle this challenge? So when we put out an advertisement, very interesting, so many people have come forward. Field test is solar-powered modular electronic toilet that is integrated with a mixed waste processing. Use of viral agents, little pathogens and odor-producing bacteria and fecal waste. Viability of using ultrasound to reduce water use in practice. That is, I can go on. Very, very innovative projects have come to handle this issue of waste disposal in this country. Because we have problems of regulation in this country still. Drug controller, we have problems. As I said, we have the guidelines for stem cell therapy. We don't have a law. Still, law is lacking. Guideline is not a law. People can flout these. Now, synthetic biology, I am talking about. There are also groups that are asking, our scientists trying their broader one. They are playing God. They are trying to create new molecules, unknown molecules. Do they know what they are creating? Therefore, there is an international regulatory body now. But India is not anywhere even thinking about, we are still talking about approving old drugs, creating problems, that is where we are, our regulation has to change. And meanwhile, we have cyber security as a mission. So when you are talking about DNA, when you are talking about individual data, data analytics, DNAs of individuals will be stored, there should be security for somebody's DNA. That becomes a role of data analytics and cyber security becomes an important issue. The hope is, startups. Have startups as many. Encourage all these major institutions, DBT, DST, CSIR. I have calculated that something like 3,000, 4,000 laboratories. Laboratories and institutions, big institutions. Each one of them can have 5, 10 startups. And these are all young people who want to try. And many of these have proof of principle. They can hand it over to the startups. And the startups would like to take them to develop, deliver a product. See, scientists don't have to spend time developing the product. The product will be developed by the startups. They want ideas. They want proof of principle. And this is where hope is. So India is planning something like 2,000 startups. But I must tell you what China is thinking. China says in 115 universities, we will create 1,000 incubators and support 80,000 startups. We can't even think big sometimes. We are thinking of 2,000 startups, they are thinking of 80,000 startups. What revolution it will make? These are all young people who have bright ideas who want to take it further. We need manufacturing facilities are still lacking in this country.
Government has to have a policy. For example, one example, I'll give you H1N1. There was a lot of knee-jerk reaction when H1N1 came. They said, oh, we need a vaccine. So we pushed one company to make H1N1, but it's very strange. Then you put the antigen in the chicken and then they able to contain the antibody. That vaccine was made. But they took about 3 more months to make the vaccine. By the time vaccine was made, the H1N1 disappeared. So the company came to us and said, what do we do with the vaccine? There are millions of doses. There is no buyer. That is where government has to be public health required. Therefore, the government should be the buyer for some of it. It will not work in private system like that. We still have critical mass, needed vaccination with the right to investment is a problem. We need innovation. That is where we need from licensing to manufacturing. Regulatory mechanisms have to be improved. It is still a government initiative. I also found there's a lack of interest, understanding of the sector. Somehow, biotechnology people don't understand it very much. They would have to get insurance. They said, you really don't need all that for innovation is a simple idea. I always end up my talk with giving this example. The lack of a college degree or any engineering training didn't stop Mark Costa. Millions dying from reused needles and doing something wrong. He wanted to prevent death due to reuse of needles. You know, millions of people are dying because of reuse of drug users, etc., etc. All that he did was to create a syringe, which is, he called it K1, locking ring in the bottom of the barrel so that when the plunger is fully depressed, it stays there. Trying to pull the plunger back would snap the ring and effectively break the syringe. So you can't reuse this because this plunger will get stuck at the bottom. That is the principle of this needleless, reusable, don't use the reusable needles, and now this has been further improved. I think this is considered one of the very important innovations of the decade. This is the guy, he said, if I can do it, he said, you can do it. Thank you so much.
So my question is, China is more ahead of this thing, validating these Ayurvedic medicines, drugs. So where the India stands in these Ayurvedic medicines, and why it is not so popular in these
things? This is what I feel. Ayurvedic medicine has to be tested using modern scientific. And their data should be published in international medical journals. There is a disbelief that Ayurvedic drugs are really working. In fact, a set of British professors wrote an article in Lancet, which is a very major medical journal, saying, oh, Ayurvedic drugs all contain heavy metals, they are toxic. They were referring to this problem. But the physician actually tells these are not toxic, they are made as nanoparticles. The processing by which these customers pastas are made, apparently it loses the toxicity. And it has been taken along with certain things, then only the toxicity is not. But somebody says, they don't know, they simply write. But we don't have authentic data to show it is not. Like this is the problem in India.
The past history of humankind
That is the problem here. In fact, people have told me, sir, I have got certificate from Prime Minister, I have got certificate from Chief Minister. This does not sell in the international community. You have to have scientific data. That is, in fact, we have mounted a few projects actually saying, see, there is a very good Ayurvedic formulation for arthritis. See, Ayurvedic formulation especially are very good, in my opinion, for autoimmune disease. Arthritis is one. Many of these. And what one has to do is doing it, compare this with one set of people, and use the modern allopathic drug, another arm. Both the arms have to be compared, and then shown, is it superior or at least as good as that, or is it less toxic? That kind of study is needed for the international community to accept it. That has not happened. You can't simply say, I have been using it for 1,000 patients, I have been training for 100 years. But is it, people say, is it placebo? You know what a placebo is? It's not a real drug. It's drug like, you feel it's a drug, and you feel happy. You know, any trial, when I say, they will say, you should do a placebo trial. Your tablet will be made exactly like your drug, but it will have no drug in that.
Yes.
If your drug is only as good as this, placebo, that means it's not due to drug. It is due to your self-motivation. The talk is working. That's the issue.
Thank you.
Yeah. I have one question regarding rabies vaccine.
Yeah.
See, actually, there was a talk that some of the plants, like banana or something, but that does not come to the market or...
No, many of them are just like that. These are
not very expensive to get the vaccine.
Not really. Like, I know our U.S. They have expressed the rabies antigen in a plant system.
Plant system,
but it has... See, people have to take some initiative also. You have to go to industry. Industry has to come forward. Industry cannot commercialize these products actually. These are some of, that is why Thyrac is now proving to be a good system for all these people to. Industry can come and then say, I have this technology, the university has this technology, will take it forward. And Thyrac will support that kind of thing. That has not been happening. Like that, so many things are there in the laboratory, they are just remain in the laboratory.
And how does this DNA vaccine work?
No, I had to do a separate lecture for that. So we made this DNA vaccine long back. It's actually an interesting story. What you do, see, rabies vaccine is nothing but the virus itself. The inactivated rabies virus is the vaccine. Now, there's a particular protein called the G protein in the rabies. That is the one that is protected. If you don't have to give the virus, you give the G protein. It will make antibodies and protect against the virus. We made the DNA for the gene protein. Not the protein. The protein vaccine. One step forward, you take the DNA, the gene for that, and then you make a vaccine. The advantage of DNA vaccine is, it is stable at room temperature. Like other vaccines, I told you, you have to store in the cold. DNA vaccine need not be stored in the cold.
But that has to go and incorporate into our...
Yeah, it goes in, it doesn't get stripped, but the DNA vaccine goes in and it expresses the protein, our body expresses the protein, and that is antibodies are made and animal is protected.
But do you use a virus carrier like...
No, we just gave DNA vaccine, directly injected DNA vaccine. And I tell you, this was done, now I can tell the story, Indian Immunologicals, we collaborated with them. First DNA vaccine in the country. All the tough people said, oh, your DNA vaccine will go and integrate into the human DNA, blah, blah, all that. For that, after 2 years of toxicity studies were done. After all that, the DCGA, the animal commissioner, also gave permission as a dog vaccine to the dog. But the company did not pursue. Why? The vaccine they are selling now is at for 200 rupees plus. DNA vaccine will be 50 rupees. So the company doesn't. So this is where I was telling public health problem. Government has to say, we will come forward and buy this vaccine. See, industry, they doesn't see, they would rather go for a 200 rupee vaccine sell. Why do they sell a 50 rupee vaccine? That's the story of the DNA vaccine. Yeah.
Sir, what are the differences between vaccine and injections?
Vaccine and?
Injections.
Vaccine and injections.
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 Yeah. It's just injection, syringe, you are talking, no?
Vaccine and injection.
Injection is what? Injection is a process that you can introduce, no?
Yes, yes.
Vaccine is a product, vaccine is a protein. I don't know how you compare the two with all. If you take a needle and you push the vaccine.
Sir, for hearing loss and dengue, you have developed some vaccine?
Yes. ICGB, International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology in New Delhi. There is one Naveen Khanna who has made a dengue vaccine, modern dengue vaccine, which has, dengue has got, as I said, 4 serotypes. The vaccine has to protect against then 1, 2, 3, 4. He has made that vaccine, it's undergoing trial. That is, otherwise we are now importing from China, Korea, that we do. But this is a modern vaccine, both for each other.
About hearing loss, something you mentioned in the slide.
Sure.
About hearing loss. Hearing loss.
Hearing loss, yeah, yeah.
What development?
No, there is a company which is trying to measure the hearing loss and, you know, I don't exactly remember the details of this. I think the problem is with children. If the child to really identify those children which, who cannot hear, I think they have a device which can measure it.
Because I saw...
That's right. One of the products is that.
Thank you, sir.
One of them. See, I have seen for 500 projects approval, I have seen 5,000 projects. Okay. So it's difficult for me to remember, but I try to read at least the abstract of these projects. Yeah, sir.
Expiry date
actually, you need chemistry to do. Really, if you want to say the drug has expired, the potency was. Either the chemistry has changed or the biology has changed. Otherwise, you have to believe on the date that is given. You know, when they say that, they would have done all the stability studies in their laboratory. If they did the stability studies, they normally, what should I say, if they say the drug is stable for 6 months, they will put a lesser, supposed to put a lesser date. They will say it is stable only for 4 months. Expiry date is less than the actual expiry date. But that doesn't mean you should be taking an expired. It's very wrong to take drugs which have exceeded their time of data.
Available life of the drug.
But if you really want to prove it is expired, the date that you have to do chemistry. Whether the molecule has changed, number one. Or two, you have to go back to the laboratory and test whether it is working in your model system. There is no other way by which you can say.
Will you expire drugs will be dangerous?
Pardon?
Will you place it dangerous?
It will be, this is what people say, but our, they say you should not be taking such drugs. Because especially if the molecule has changed, many of these are stored and drugs can undergo oxidation. So it is not the primary drug anymore, it is oxidized. It's a different molecule. And you do not know what is the consequence of taking such a molecule. So it's better to avoid, you should. I'm telling you, when you buy the molecule, you just bring the tablet, you don't even look at the expiry date. That is that. But it's not good to take drugs.
So, Madhupai, last question is, there are trillions of anti-